Bonjour tout le monde. Talk about a tone shift for the channel, right? I spent the last month talking about Pokemon, and here it is now, a month late for Halloween, and I'm tackling an indie horror game instead. As I noted long ago when writing my blog description, topical consistency is not my strong suit. The original Darkest Dungeon, a dungeon-crawling RPG with turn-based combat and a grim Lovecraftian aesthetic released by Red Hook Studios back in 2016, was a game I struggled to get into. It had a wonderful sense of flavor and some basic gameplay elements that were right up my alley, but they were paired with other elements that were decidedly less so, like procedurally generated dungeons and a permadeath mechanic far more punishing than even I, as a veteran Fire Emblem player, could possibly stomach. I picked up Darkest Dungeon several times over the years, but inevitably, after a while, I'd get overwhelmed by its abundance of poorly explained systems and disheartened by permanently losing characters I'd spent hours building up, and I could never make it to the end. And I'm not one of those people with a bunch of unfinished games lying around. It's very rare for me to start a game and never finish it, so that should tell you something about both how much I wanted to like Darkest Dungeon and how much the reality of playing it was just not working for me. But now, it's the end of 2021, and the sequel is in early access over on Epic Games. The aesthetic flair of the originals has been preserved in all its glory, now updated with 3D models for a rather effective hybrid look, and the core gameplay still revolves around turn-based combat. So what's new in Darkest Dungeon 2? Quite a lot, really. Instead of dungeon crawling while using resources to build up a town on the side, gameplay outside of combat takes the form of a road trip from hell, a journey to the snowy mountain that's the source of all the eldritch horrors that have been unleashed upon this world. The paths you take along the way are what dictate the encounters you'll face and how you'll manage your various resources. And although the lack of a hamlet to return to means far fewer systems of development, there's still a bunch of room for player choice. And also for being trapped at the mercy of the RNG, as befits the tone of fighting against often hopeless odds. Perhaps one of the biggest mechanical changes is your choice of traveling companions. In both games, you build parties of four out of a selection of heroes. The heroes of Darkest Dungeon correspond to a variety of low fantasy classes, and in fact are typically referred to by their class names, since the player can change their given names at any time. But at the same time, they're clearly meant to be distinct individuals with their own backstories. In the original game, however, it's quite possible to acquire multiples of the same hero and even build teams with them, like human versions of Pokemon using positive and negative quirks in place of IVs to set them apart from others of their own class. This was obviously intended as a workaround to Darkest Dungeon's brutal take on permadeath, which is paired with the game's constantly auto-saving to prevent the player from getting around the mechanic by resetting like in Fire Emblem. Now, the concept of playable characters getting irreversibly killed off due to bad luck or player error is always going to play havoc with the game's writing one way or another. I could do a whole video on how this is still a problem in Fire Emblem, even with recent games putting in place multiple mechanics to circumvent permadeath, but for the first Darkest Dungeon, it boils down to the straightforward observation that the playable heroes have to double as characters, with stories of their own revealed in short comics published online and alluded to in-game with flavor text on their items, and as disposable and endlessly duplicated units that you throw at the opposition until at least one of them lives long enough to down the final boss. That's bleak, sure. But having multiples of the same hero is a feature that doesn't contribute either way to the game's tone, and it's just kinda strange altogether. That's not the case, though, in Darkest Dungeon 2. At the start, you're given a choice of 9 heroes, 8 of whom return from the first game, and have to build a party of no more than one of each. If a hero dies during one stretch of the journey, but you manage to limp your way to the nearest inn checkpoint, a hero from the ones you didn't pick at the beginning will be randomly chosen to replace them. If your whole party wipes, which will happen often, you're simply sent back to the start and are allowed to pick a new set of 4 heroes from the same selection. Each time this happens, your profile gets upgraded with a resource called Hope that increases based on your performance, and as your profile rank increases, you permanently unlock new features. These include new items and quirks, but they also include the 5 heroes who aren't unlocked when you start a new game. DD2's complexity opens up gradually as you push your way through more and more of its challenges, which is both less overwhelming for new players and provides an incentive to keep trying in the face of repeated failure. More than that, though, it fixes my issue with duplicate heroes from the first game, which is even more important as DD2 includes hero shrines as one of its many roadside stops. These properly integrate the characters' backstories into the games for the first time, laying them out for players and even allowing you to experience some moments firsthand through battles that play out like puzzles to be solved. As a reward for clearing hero shrines, you permanently unlock new skills on the heroes that go through them, giving you an additional meta goal to work toward and opening up different playstyles for each hero. As someone whose gaming background lies much more in RPGs than in roguelikes, this attention to characterization is a much appreciated change. There's still room for variance in each run thanks to the return of the quirk system, as well as the mastery system for upgrading skills that allows you to build up your heroes according to your team composition and the specific needs of each run. So aside from the total roster of heroes being about half the size of the roster in DD1, I don't feel like much of substance has really been lost here. The heroes serving as discrete characters now also plays into DD2's new relationship system, where your party will build positive and negative affinity with each other on the road, leading to all manner of additional effects. I do think that there's a lot of room to improve the affinity system as it currently stands, because a lot of it lies outside the player's control and as such feels pretty random. There are ways to improve affinity through items, and the stress mechanic returning from DD1 also plays a role where keeping it low is essential to avoiding too much negative affinity. But even if your heroes are all madly in love with one another, and I mean that too, one of the positive relationship statuses is amorous, yummy, it's impossible to predict and therefore play around the benefits you get from that. Also, heroes interrupt combat to make comments about each other based on affinity, and while positive ones can offer helpful buffs, they disrupt the pace of combat, especially later in a run where you'll usually get several affinity-based interruptions every single turn. I do think the relationship system is a promising improvement over the afflictions generated by high stress in DD1, in that they make you think more about your party as a group since you can't just shuffle other heroes in and out at will, but it definitely needs some fine-tuning. The same can also be said of how the unlock system works, because while adding new items and quirks gives you more to work toward, the order in which heroes and skills get unlocked is set in stone, which can often feel rather arbitrary. Too bad if you really like the leper or the occultist, because they're the last two heroes you'll unlock. And in the same way, the order in which heroes learn new skills from shrines is also fixed. Some characters, most notably the Hellion from my experience, start off with an unimpressive kit and only really start coming into their own once several of their later skills become available. There's also the matter of mastery points, which are earned throughout each run and can be used to upgrade skills. These upgrades don't carry over from run to run, and this becomes an issue as some skill upgrades can be borderline essential depending on your team composition, and you won't get many mastery points on your journey, making it often infeasible to explore alternative options. For instance, you only get a single mastery point going into the first full leg of the journey, and because regular healing is so limited in DD2 and because stress management is absolutely essential, that point is almost certainly going to go toward upgrading a heal or a stress heal. These roles can be taken instead by consumable items, but as it's completely random which items you'll come across as loot or in shops, there's no way to plan around having that as an option. As a result, unless you get lucky or just like to live dangerously, you're not going to get around to upgrading offensive skills until later on in a run, and as the game is now, some are clearly better than others. This is most noticeable when it comes to the combo token mechanic. Some skills apply combo tokens to enemies, and other skills interact with those tokens in various ways. It's an interesting concept, and a fun way to play around with skill synergies, but the problem is that there's only 3 or 4 methods across all characters and skills to apply combo tokens without upgrading. And likewise, many of the effects that use tokens are also gated behind mastery points. While I was able to take advantage of combo tokens to an extent in the run you're watching now, a big reason for that is that I ran a cultist, whose Daemon's Pull is by far the most reliable source of combo tokens before any upgrades. Without him, I would have been faced with the prospect of spending at least 2 mastery points for a consistent token builder and spender pair, which would have narrowed my options even more. Still, DD2 is in early access at the moment, and there's a lot to be changed and added before its final release. Right now, only the first of 5 levels is available, so it's reasonable to expect that mechanics that are currently underutilized, like stuns for players and stealth for both sides, will get more focus and content down the road. How exactly future levels will work within the road trip structure remains to be seen, as is whether more heroes will be added later on. There's still quite a few of them left from DD1 to be added back in, although based on a mini-boss I happened to encounter in this run, they may not necessarily come back as playable. But regardless, I'm looking forward to what DD2 has in store as it continues through early access. And if you played and enjoyed the first game, or, like me, have taken an interest in the series but struggled to get into the original, I recommend checking this one out. As I mentioned earlier, I do find DD2 more accessible to newer players. And while it's still relentlessly challenging and you will fail many times before you succeed, there's plenty of incentive to try again. As it happens, the footage for this video comes from my very first time completing a run after so many attempts that I lost count a long time ago. I was absolutely not expecting that, especially with a team setup that I haven't spent too much time with, but I pulled it off in the end somehow. I made the full unedited run, including a very down-to-the-wire final boss fight, available as a bonus for my patrons whose support is always deeply appreciated for allowing me to continue making content like this. Consider checking that out yourself if you're interested, but definitely like and subscribe to let me know you enjoyed the video. If you played Darkest Dungeon 2 or are thinking about trying it out, tell me about your experiences in the comments. What works for you, what doesn't, all that good stuff. Engagement on my videos helps me get a feel for the kind of content my subscribers like to see, so it helps me and gets you more of what you like. Au revoir!